Thank you everyone for joining. And today we have with us Aditya Prasad Narisetty. He is, first of all, a very dear friend. We have known each other for a fairly long time now. We went to college together. So we've been friends for a long time. And I'll just share a little bit about Aditya, and then we can start with a few questions that you guys have already submitted, and then we will open it up. So you will be able to ask questions with Aditya too. In the invite, you may have seen, I mentioned Aditya is the lead data scientist at Dream 11. So that has changed. Aditya is now the principal data scientist at Dream 11. So yeah, congrats, Aditya. Dream 11, just to give you some context, it is India's largest fantasy sports platform with over 100 million users. Tens of millions of users are using the platform as we speak, possibly. And Aditya leads the data science work at Dream 11. Previously, Aditya has led data science teams at Craftswilla and Housing, and Aditya holds a degree in mechanical engineering from the Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay. On the personal side, Aditya is also one of the most passionate and self-driven people I know, who can totally immerse themselves into any domain or activity that they choose to pursue. In fact, I don't know if you've heard about this thing called the Ironman Triathlon. And maybe I'll just read out the Wikipedia description just to give you a sense. The Ironman Triathlon is a series of long distance triathlon races, which consists of 3.86 kilometer swim, followed by a 180 kilometer bicycle ride, followed by a 42 kilometer run, all of which you have to complete within the same day. And it is widely considered one of the most difficult one day sporting events in the world, which Aditya has completed. Yeah, it's pretty exciting to have you, Aditya, and thanks a lot for taking the time out for being with us.
Thanks, Akash. Thank you for the kind introduction. Hello, everyone. Just to clarify a couple of things, me and a couple of my colleagues at Dream 11 lead the entire data science team. I'm one of the leads, and I'm more of an individual contributor and guiding the mentors.
Okay. All right. So maybe I would love to begin with just understanding your journey before you got into data science and machine learning, because I know that you did not have formal education in this domain, right? So what did that look like before you got into data science and ML? Just if you can talk a little bit about education and work, and yeah, maybe we can start there.
So I never had any programming experience or machine learning experience before. I even gave my interviews during placements, but I was more into financial engineering, and I was interested in statistics a bit. But during the placements, I started a little bit into programming, and then during my work breaks, I realized that I was passionate more about analytics domain in a way. And then when I joined my second company there, the entire data science team was working on some cool things. This was housing.com. I've started taking up some online courses during that time, back in 2013 or something. And during that time, my work in statistics and also mathematical modeling helped a lot. And one of the key things I learned early on in the career was building things at scale. And this helped me push towards developing products at all. And as Akash has mentioned, I didn't have any formal education in this domain, so it was very difficult to keep on catching up, and also never had the confidence to grow in the industry as well. It took a lot of time to realize the tool sets which make, and what are the challenges in the industry, and the reading resources out there. Especially there are a lot of reading resources out there. They were all intimidating at first, but one problem at a time, solving them gave me the confidence and moving on. Especially the building products at scale when you work for a company, that's what you learn apart from your Kaggle competitions or any hackathon projects. So that was the confidence which kept on building up. And obviously there's a community of people. Akash was present, my friends and colleagues who are a part of, you know, formal education, who got masters, and some of them who got PhDs. Associating with them, then we get to learn more in the community and slowly start growing.
Great. Thanks a lot for providing that background. And I think I want to dig deeper into a couple of things there. The first thing you mentioned is you started taking up some online courses on data science. So what got you interested in data science and machine learning in the first place?
Even now, I don't see machine learning as a domain which is pure applied machine learning or data science. This is purely a problem solving domain for me. And earlier when I was working on financial engineering and the problem statements in computation investment, I used to pick up a lot of Coursera courses on social network analysis, statistical modeling, and game theory. So these were some of the core concepts which were building me up to problem solving skills. And at the same time, you know, the courses which I really wanted to take on machine learning was go and do a master's at that point. But I've realized that the problem statements which were in the industry itself were challenging and the material was already available. Right. And I personally, at that point in time, didn't feel like master's would help me. That's a different question we can address later. Yeah, so the courses which I, at that point in time, 2012 or 13, was, you know, there were a couple of courses by Jan Lippen and then some reading material on Coursera. These are the ones I started out with, but later on started reading research papers. I never liked to read research papers. I just wanted to skim through them and get some analysis. And this was long ago, like 7-8 years ago. But then making the time to read one research paper at least a week or so helped me put in the time to be spent.
Yeah. Okay, that's very interesting. And one of the interesting decisions that you made early on, I think, and you touched on this talking about problems in the industry, was after working for some time at a larger company, you decided to take a shot at like by joining a startup and working on their data science team. So what went into that decision? And you also briefly touched on masters, and you know, what made you feel that maybe getting into like a real world scenario would be better than pursuing a master's, for example?
Yeah, so there are obviously a lot of clear benefits with masters, and a couple of my colleagues have extraordinary in the field, by the way. But for me personally, when I was working in housing.com and also my first company, which was in transactions companies, where we were doing fraud detection analysis and these, this built me up for an appetite towards solving problem statements. So solving problem statements in the sense, when a Kaggle competition or any hackathon comes up, they give you a problem, the features and everything which are pre-built for us, and we run a model, submit it, and compete. We get that high over a weekend and then get out of it. Right. But in the industry, we have to build all those from scratch, like hundreds of features. We go through them, and sometimes you sit 2 to 3 weeks altogether, and those features are never coming close. You don't even observe any deltas, and then you start thinking about it not just from an analytics perspective, but researching in that domain. What all other things you can do, right? So maybe even a completely different feature from a completely different domain, like macroeconomics of that particular country, whatever, right? So these are the things which can keep your mind engaged always, which I found interesting. Right. And startups give us this opportunity of tackling these problems from, I would say, from scratch. So if one goes to find companies, they would have to work on a part of a problem statement, which is mostly starting from analytics, right?
Yep.
Obviously, they are solving a very huge and big problems which we refer to always, but building something from scratch and getting in the features, going through the rigorous cycle of development, and at the same time hiring your team, expanding, they're all something which grows in you and makes you a better data scientist.
Right, makes sense. So it seems like it has more than machine learning in particular, it has been about solving problems, solving hard, interesting problems, and then figuring out what you need to, even maybe learning on the job or learning on the side, trying to figure out what the best resource, and talking to people, talking to your communities is a big part of how you learn data science.
Yeah, correct, Akash. And talking to the community, I would say, is one of the biggest part. And I'm glad Akash is doing a lot of good work in this domain. because unless and until you are connected to the community, like say you are on Twitter following Binance in our field, or somebody who is working in your domain, let's say you're working on some fraud detection problem in a company, you follow all those people who are actively publishing in this domain, you get really good inputs, what they have tried. So you as an individual or a contributor could never beat the community intelligence as a whole. So always studying other people's work will make you better. And that's what I find personally.
Great. One other thing I think very, very closely related I want to touch on is, especially for a lot of people who may not have any formal training in data science or machine learning, there is always this fear that I do not know enough, or I do not know, like I don't have enough, I need to learn more, I need to study more before I can approach a problem or before I can build a project. You seem to have taken the opposite approach. How did you fight that fear? How did you fight that syndrome that of not, of like feeling like I don't know enough, how can I solve this project or things like that? And I know that you have learned so much. Now you probably know a lot more than people with advanced masters or degrees in the field. But like initially in that early point, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, honestly speaking, even now I consider there is a lot for me to learn. And sometimes I feel like there's something more which could be done. But yeah, Akash, as you mentioned, initially when I started out, there's a lot of literature out there, and how much ever amount of work was, let's say the initial 6 months which I've put in doing the courses, I've done 4 or 5 courses as well, but they never gave me that confidence, right? The more I studied, the more it felt that it's a well which you can never come out of, right? But what really gave me the confidence is picking up the projects, solving one by one, right? So in a company, when you do deliver 2 products, 3 products, that kind of confidence build you, and then a team grows around you, and then you know the problem, the approach to a problem solving is more important than what kind of a model or theory which you've used. So more and more problems you solve, the better you'll overcome this fear. But first step is to keep on trying.
Great, thanks for that. So maybe now we can talk a little more on the technical side of the kind of things that you have worked on. Now, can you maybe lay out a roadmap for us? What kind of problems in data science, machine learning did you start looking at initially? What kind of models were you building? How did you go from there? Because it's a fast evolving field, and I know you have approached a different, fairly different domain of problems over the years.
Yeah, sure. So let me talk about the kind of problem statements I've worked on before, till now in my career as well. So in housing, we used to build a personalization engine. I was more involved in the data engineering and machine learning engineering part. And then building the entire personalization system, driving the revenues. This is where we built the product and saw that, you know, we could improve the revenue. That was the proof of concept. Right. And then we built the whole machine learning platform around it, and then people could build their models. And then I moved into marketing, where I had to improve the conversion rate in there. A simple baseline model was effective. It didn't go to prod. If it would have, I think it would have been maybe different later on. Then I had an opportunity to work in Google. I couldn't get enough work in there, so I decided to join a startup in Classfula, where I was working on relevance, search, personalization, ranking, and demand and supply forecasting. So these are all multiple problem statements which one simple startup had.
Right.
And this startup, this was doing decent enough, good amount of revenue, but that 1% improvement which you can make in, let's say, a search conversion, and 1% during deposits or eventually transacting, that can mean like 5 to 10% more in revenue, which means beating the competitors.
Right.
So once I got the feel of how this can directly impact the company, and most of the startups are looking for funding, right? Growth in revenue is equal into the funding they raise. So you're directly contributing to the funding and the growth of the entire company as a whole. So these problem statements, which were varied across the domain, 5 different problem statements, researching around.
Right.
Gave me a little bit of those confidence, right? And then when I'm working in Dream 11, it's similar problems,
right?
Startups to startup, the problem statements don't change, but then for Dream11, I had a different experience going into a leadership role. The problems which we solved were from scratch, but once you put out the initial models out there, then comes the most challenging part. How do you iterate on it? Now comes 0.1%, 0.2% improvements. You are going after lot of features which might not give any relevant results. We conduct like hundreds of offline experiments and not even 5% come out successful. But we do put in the time, because those 5% of the experiments can lead to like 1% higher revenue. So we keep on trying.
Right. So one thing I think I want to understand here is, you mentioned that in Craftsvilla you were going through all of these different kinds of models and all of these different kinds of problems. So you were learning on the job while you were doing all of these, or?
I had an enthusiastic team who used to come to the office and say, okay, today let's solve this problem, right? A good motivating team, which you can find out, is also important.
Right. So that willingness to just approach a problem and to be able to have the confidence that we will figure it out. We'll try all the different things that are available. We'll read papers if we have to. We'll look up GitHub repositories. That seems to be a very important part of like real data science work.
And most of you guys who are budding data scientists, initially when you go to a bigger company, probably you'll be working on one of the problem, but you'll go depth in it. But when you go for a startup, you would be requiring a wide kind of knowledge. You try out 4 to 5 different problem statements, release one of the core features. Even that small feature is gonna have a very big impact in there.
Yeah. Well, one other thing that you touched on was understanding the business and understanding the impact of what you're doing on the business. And I think you've done that well. You explained that for housing Craftsvilla. How important is it for data science professionals, practitioners, to understand the business versus to, I mean, focus primarily on just building models and things like that?
Okay. I'm not sure if this statistic is right. I'm also quoting it again from some other source. A recent survey done by the CEOs mentioned that 93% of the data science teams don't deliver. I'm not sure of this statistic, but I heard from somewhere. Okay. So it's very imperative that people are trying out several different kind of models, right? And they are approaching these problems. You conduct hundreds of experiments, many of them fail. But at the same time, we shouldn't lose concentration on delivering the best product or a neural network based model or anything. Try to release a baseline model. Sometimes the product team or the business is just looking for a baseline personalization or a fraud detection model which solves their problem 50-60% of the time. So you release it in a very naive fashion, even write some couple of if else conditions as well, right? From your own heuristics. That's going to solve the problem half the way in a startup,
right?
And then go on to build on top of this when you see that the business impact is tightly coupled with it. When the business thinks that you've got a 50% accuracy, still nothing is happening, you may give another 2-3 months, build a complicated model, but keep checking with the business always.
Right. So anytime you're building any kind of machine learning project or data science project, just understanding what the business requirements are, what are acceptable metrics, all of that is seems to be pretty important.
Yeah, I would say they are the most important. Before we pick up any project, we ask people to jot down the metrics. What are the key performance indicators and what is one metric which the business is moving, right? We call them North Star or overall evaluation criteria. Unless we have that right, we are just lost in a haze. And sometimes you might not improve your primary metric, but you're going to find out some accidental discoveries in the process. And then the business is going to reinvent that problem. So it's going to be funny, but it works. Yes. So metrics are the first and foremost we need.
Makes sense. One other thing I want to touch on there is about the kind of models, the kind of, like you mentioned about creating baseline models and simple models. One of the things that we often find as we are conducting a machine learning course right now is we start with some simpler models like linear regression, logistic regression, simple decision trees. And sometimes people tend to have this notion that these models are too simple and they are not applicable in the real world. And I think that is false, but then I would love to hear from you because I believe two things. One is that in a lot of cases, they give you a pretty good result. And second, there is also a question of explainability and interpretability, which again is a tricky thing with neural networks and GBMs, etc. So can you talk about simple models, interpretability, and the business perspective there? Because you've seen this in the real world.
Yeah, sure. As I've seen most of the projects which I've done in my career, even the business, right? The product and the business is never going to ask you the accuracy or how good the model is on production. They're going to ask, how did you solve it? Because they would need to answer for the business stakeholders. And also the product needs to think about its repercussions. Suppose you use some biasing model, which is going to be racially biased. So the product team needs to know about it. So explainability is one of the important problems, but that comes in at a very early stage. Once you start building the baseline models, the product becomes mature, then, you know, explainability is more from a data science perspective, how you're going to get that lift and for your own sake. Many people wouldn't consider this model explainability or, you know, try to go for the more complicated model straight away. But in that process, what we really miss is the learning curve and also understanding the business problem statement. So business problem statement, you will understand while building the baseline model, then regression or a GPT model, right? You get the incremental lifts. And I honestly couldn't think of a project where neural networks completely outperformed by more than 2 to 3% lift compared to a baseline model. That is very hard to find. Everything we get is from feature engineering only. So studying the features, doing the causal analysis, regression analysis, error analytics. Only after doing all these, we get a clear understanding of the problem. Then we approach complicated models to see, hey, I have this new feature. Can this model leverage it? And not that model will definitely solve. And that was my perspective.
And just related to that, when you work on a project, typically over the life cycle, let's say if it's a 2 month project, what percentage of your time goes into analyzing the data, you know, looking at different graphs, correlations, fixing missing data, going back and telling people that, hey, there's something wrong here in data entry issues, and the cleaning it up and designing features before you actually get to the modeling part?
Okay, so before getting to the modeling part, I would say this is like 80-90% of our time. From a startup perspective, you might have, we can do it in like 1 to 2 weeks because naive features are a little bit easier to build, right, for the baseline models. But when you are working in a company which is a large scale industry and the revenue implications are also huge, you want to work on all these features, explain to multiple business service owners and everybody why you need to build them, the pipelines designed for it and everything, right? Only after doing all this, we pick up. But in a startup, you know, you go through the data, prepare those features on your own, run the baseline models, offline tests, and then you go present it to the product or business, they're going to pick it up and roll it out. But I would say that post-metric formulation, this comes before the metric itself. We need to give a hypothesis, right? So I'll talk about from a Dreamland perspective and not a startup. In here, let's say we need a new feature, which is whether the match is being televised on the network or not, right? And this feature is very complex to build. Sometimes it takes like 6 months to get the data, and we might have to put in some millions of dollars in order to fetch this feature. And business will not sign off unless and until you have some kind of a hypothesis or data to back it. So to prove that, you have to go back and run some correlated features or scrape those from somewhere and prove that this is going to be the impact. Only then the business will sign off on it.
Right. So it seems like a large part of data science and even machine learning work is actually more of data wrangling, visualization, analysis, feature engineering, and not so much tuning. I mean, that is also a part, like tuning hyperparameters, etc. But like even before you get to the modeling, that's like a huge huge piece, and not something that you should take lightly.
So the percentages keep varying across time.
Right. Different. Okay. Depends on the size of the problem. Yeah.
Right. But I always keep thinking 50 to 70% of the time, it's about feature engineering, parsing the data, cleaning it up, transforming the data sets and research, and 5 to 10% of the time in deciding on which model and getting everybody on the same page.
Right.
5 to 10% of the time, it's the model and the hyperparameters. Actually, it's not even that, 1 to 2% maybe. Because there are libraries which can do that for you, and hyperparameter tuning also at scale. And the rest, 20 to 30% of the time is error analytics. You go back, see why your model has failed, study it, which features were missing or which features could have given the advantage, and then go back, restart the process again. Yeah, so modeling is only like 5 to 10%, not maybe even. Let's cap it at 5% at this point.
That's an interesting perspective from the real world. And one last thing related just to your work is, because you also lead, you've led several projects and teams, I just want to understand from you, what is the importance of communication with business, and like what kind of things do you communicate or present? Because that is often a missed piece, especially if you're learning, focusing more on the technical aspects, you miss this communication and this like sort of getting all stakeholders together. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Wonderful. I think Akash, you're asking all the questions which the entire data science workflow has one by one. So communication is a very key aspect with the business, because you always need to get in touch with them. The moment you get out of the reality of the business problem statement, transparency issues will come in. I've had this, I can honestly say that, because that was a huge learning curve for me. The moment we start thinking that this is not a cool product to build, your business ko pata nahi hai, product ko pata nahi hai, we start working on something for 2 to 3 months on ourselves. When there is a lack of communication and transparency goes missing, you're not just putting yourself, but the project and the entire team at risk. So we regularly have like weekly sync up with the products every time. Okay. In a startup, I would say keep doing it every day also, because the dynamics changes much faster. Over communication is always better for sure, because even the slightest of the things which you think that, let's say one of the features gave you 0.2% lift, but it is the most important in your decision splits, you go and share that information with the product. Maybe they don't use it in your project, but that will be applicable for the business to prioritize that user group or do a user research around that study. So rather than helping you, you help the business in a way you can't imagine.
So there's a constant communication that you need to have, otherwise things will diverge too much, right? And when you are communicating with the business teams, obviously not all of them or very few of them might understand a lot of the technical details or the jargon involved in data science and machine learning, or even like the loss functions and ROC scores, etc. So what, any tips on how to simplify this communication or how to communicate effectively to a non-technical audience?
Very good question, because the way in which we hire people in our team as well, we think about whether people can explain these to other people as well. So it is not just the model which you're trying to explain to the product or business, but also your results as well. Why did you get this lift? What does this feature mean? What does a decision split mean? And also, why are you asking the business to spend like $1 million to build a new feature, right? So these are all going to be approved by the business only if you can communicate effectively. And also, most of the analytics and products team do understand statistical inferencing and also the deltas, lifts, and these. But how do you get them explainability is something which you constantly keep on engaging with them, and they will get to know the period of time. But initially, the concepts like loss function or hyperparameter tuning or even the decision splits, these are obviously complicated for a new member or a new business product you're talking to. The simplest way is to not to take them through your project, because then you will lose them most likely, but to take them through the results by saying, you know, you have got this baseline model, you have tried something else, and you have gotten this 2% lift. How did you get that? Right? And then you will explain what kind of a loss function. You explain that as a bare simple optimization, like a demand supply curve, which everybody is in their elementary economics class, right? So you tie it up to there, and then mention how you are taking different steps. You improve accuracy by 3% over different models. You project it, and based on those projections, people can correlate a lot.
Right. So it's a, in some sense, if I understand correctly, like they should be able to take away what is happening through the model in simple words, in a way that they can understand, right?
Yeah. And
I find it very interesting that. Sorry, you were saying something.
No, I just wanted to reemphasize that. You know, you'll be asking 3 to 4 months to build on a new feature and a new model. And from a business perspective, that is a very big ask, because obviously data pipelines, the team compensations, and the kind of platform you use, everything is expensive. So they all come at a cost. So business needs to rationalize. So you need to effectively communicate this feature gains and everything.
Okay, great. And I was saying that I find it really interesting that like just you, it's a part of your interview process to test candidates on how simply or in how simple words they can actually explain what they're doing. That's a very interesting thing I did not know about data science interviewing. That's great. So I have, I'll ask a couple more questions, Aditya, and then there are a few questions in the chat, and so we let people ask some questions too. One thing about, okay, let me see. So one question that I had is about Kaggle and about just doing a lot of different projects. I know that you've been like, when on the side, you're always working on some interesting projects or Kaggle competitions. So can you talk a little bit about some of the most interesting side projects that you've done, which were very instrumental in your learning process, apart from work?
Yeah, I honestly spent very less time on Kaggle platform itself, but I was working on a couple of hackathon projects along with my friends in the meanwhile. But I'm actively looking upon a lot of kernels on Kaggle. I look it up like once or 2 months, because this is where the core innovation comes in. Right. You know, it's not just the best practices, but the most intelligent solutions come in there. So it's always better to keep tabs on it and see what is happening in there. But apart from it, the projects which I work on is, so within the company itself, you know, like in a startup, let's say, I'm sorry to be blunt, but we are getting paid to work on a problem statement, right? So apart from it, there are several different problems which the business has on a lower priority, right? These days, with the kind of machine learning tools at our disposal, we can solve a lot of them from inference point of view or even from a causation point of view. So these are some of the things, when you keep on working, you know the entire business end to end because you put in that work. Some of the problems cannot be solved. So those are the problems you research on. And when I was working on a marketing attribution problem, there was less data, we couldn't do much. So I started reading up on it. And then I found out a Kaggle problem in there, then went on to solve it. Even though that's an expired problem, I knew that this is something which I could learn, so that once we collect enough data, it's going to be useful later on. So prepare for your future, because this problem statement will have applications for you later on.
So you, it seems like a lot of your learning has happened and continues to happen via blog posts and notebooks that people have shared on Kaggle or GitHub, or just like even trying to read papers that people are writing.
Yep. Honestly, without them, without even having a formal education in machine learning as well, it would have been impossible. But the kind of research and also output and blog posts which are out there, they will solve most of the problem statements which you guys have. And anything where the problem statement is already set up and you are looking for those small gains, then you will have to keep on doing more further and further research. And this is the applied data scientist part of it. But the other part of data scientist is the machine learning engineer. I grew in that domain first, so I can closely relate to it. And these are some of the domains which people don't publish much because nobody deals at scale. Even in a startup, they might not be seeing that scale. But when you do inferencing and deploy the models, you would have to do it, right? So for those cases, keep that handy, because the more the tools get automated and the business problem gets to a saturation point, scaling it up and how do you deliver across a larger user base is something which you need to solve. So those are the kind of things which we need to pick it up.
Mm-hmm. And I have so many questions. I'm just deciding which ones to ask. Maybe if you can quickly answer this one. You have seen different scales of data as you work through your data science career, right? What is different between working on a small problem with, let's say, a few thousand data points to something where you're generating millions of data points every day? How does that process change?
Initially, in my initial stages of my career, I never used to apply even Python parallel processing. So just to work on single core itself, that speaks volumes about the kind of data I was using, very small data sets. And putting it on production, everything was good, right? But that used to limit me from, the kind of problems I used to deal with and the kind of modules I also used to train. So let's say, from a personalization point of view or from a fraud detection at a larger scale, unless and until we look at scale in a business, your deliverables are going to be limited because you'll be spending a lot of time writing custom code bases for yourself, right? I would suggest never to build something from scratch from an engineering point of view.
Right. Because
a tool base or a pipeline which is already present, a lot of them are open source these days, orchestration frameworks and
training.
So what this helps is you will not make the mistakes the community has made over years and at larger scale as well. So yeah, thinking about approaching from a scale point of view from an early stage would help. I unfortunately didn't have that. And by the time Dream 11 grew in scale and it suddenly hit me, I was outdated.
Mm-hmm.
I took my sweet time, like around 2 to 3 months inferencing at scale. We do inferences at about a couple of devote, but maybe let's say on the north of a couple of 10 to about 16 floating point operations per day or something, right?
Wow.
We do inferencing for like north of 1 million users per day. And million users is a very conservative estimate I'm talking about.
Yep.
And these users will run at like millions of SKUs or products which are present. So unless and until we gain from that perspective, the kind of methods or blog posts we'll also read about is like basic application, right? So
right.
That would work at a smaller scale. Maybe the sample which you have taken was 10,000 users, but they're not representative of the business, which is the entire 1 million, 2 million users. Well, when you sample, you remove most of those good users or compute attributing for the business. So first thing, go and solve for a smaller problem statement itself. But before going to prod, definitely validate over all the users offline, because you don't want to be shocked after spending 6 months rolling it out for a year and mm-hmm. then realize that it's a mistake.
So you start out with like a small problem and or like reduce a problem, maybe build a solution, and then try to use existing frameworks, existing methods, and maybe even I think like coding, good coding practices, making sure that your code is parallelizable, is like is properly, you know, properly tested. All of that becomes very important as you start to go to scale, I guess.
Yep. Smaller problem statement is always good, but always do it on the entire data set before it surprises you.
Right. Okay. All right. Now, the last piece I want to touch on, and that's also what a lot of questions are about, is about getting into data science, right? And especially as somebody who does not have a formal degree or something, somebody who's been, let's say, an expert in another domain, or maybe has taken a few online courses, they want to get into data science. So what, number one, what advice would you have for somebody who's looking to get into data science? What will they, like, what should be their checklist to get their first job?
Okay. Tough question.
Tough question.
right now, the kind of candidates we interview for are somebody who has experience, like 2 to 3 years experience or a pedigree. So, I do talk to a couple of startups and help them in their hiring process. So maybe I can give that kind of overview from what a startup would be hiring from. So a startup would be expecting from a data scientist a holistic experience in statistics probably, and visualizations, feature engineering, programming skills, and also analytical thinking, right? So all these things are required. But when you go to a bigger company, you would have to go into a specialization, probably in one of the domains. So that's a different domain, right? But if you're trying to get a job initially in the machine learning field, obviously Kaggle problem statements, these are all already at your disposal. But your learning is very limited because you are working on one problem for like 3-4 months. You don't have that learning experience which a team can gather. So I would say, even if it is an unpaid internship, go ahead and do it, right? Because the expected value of your returns after being a data scientist is huge. So you can afford to probably spend 6 months being in a company wherein you can learn from the entire team altogether.
Right.
And yeah, for this case, reach out to not just people on LinkedIn, follow their work. And if you have any brilliant ideas, go and suggest them, especially on the blog post, which that's SVG does or Dream 11 does, or maybe even small startups when they tweet about it or the requirements. So that will express interest and people are going to pick you up. But from a data science point of view, how you can improve your core skill sets, they're all in those 5 domains, right? Programming, statistics, and applied math. So these are, I honestly would say that, you know, you need like 3 to 4 years to build expertise in each of these domains. So it's a slow process, but never work on one single problem statement. Keep yourself across several different domains, not because of hiring perspective, but that will give you a perspective of solving different problems from different ways. Because I think machine learning is a problem solving rather than.
So the more problems you solve, the more, I guess, then the more projects you build, the variety of projects you build, that makes you a stronger candidate. Would that be fair to say?
Come again, Akash.
I would say that the more different kinds of problems you have solved, the more different kinds of projects you have built, the variety that you have of in your project portfolio. So that makes you a strong candidate. Is that fair to say?
Definitely. Because as I was saying, it's not just the confidence, but different ways of analytical thinking or approaching a problem. That is more important. Even if you approach the same problem from 10 different perspectives, that's still better as well. But honestly, we will be tired of working on one problem when it is our pet project. So that's why you have multiple problem statements in different domains. It'll be very easy, because I made this mistake earlier. It'll be easier to stick into probably structured data and keep thinking about it. But you never know the kind of, let's take an example, right? Attention and transformer, these are something which have revolutionized the industry. So they found applications in structured data as well. And people who were working on GBDTs, they were completely caught unaware of this. So it's always better to have multiple perspectives of solving the problem.
Right. So keep trying out different models, different problems, different domains, different data sets. That's interesting. And any, you interview a lot of people for data science roles, both like entry level roles, senior roles. What are some of the most common things that you feel are missing in when candidates are interviewing? Any insights on that?
From a resume screening point of view as well, first, the way in which we write the resume as well, right? Mostly people will be putting in all the buzzwords in there, right? It becomes very difficult for us to attribute, because based on my experience, typically people put in a lot of them in a limited span of 1 to 2 years wouldn't have done enough justice across one of them. So for a fresher or even like a person with 3 to 4 years of experience, explain more about the project, which one of the projects, and how well you have done it, and what all perspectives have you covered it, and the tools which you've used, right? And then the other things you can mention as additional skill set as well. Because during a resume screening, out of hundreds of resumes, if somebody puts in so much junk in there, it's better not to go with it, right? But there might be people who might be, that's just my preference for my team. I might be wrong. Then from the telephonic interview and the first round and the second round, what specifically we look for is, did the candidate even approach the problem from an analytical thinking point of view, right? If he says that, I've applied regression, then neural networks, and then I did the hyperparameter tuning, we say, okay, that's, let's put it aside. What is the problem statement? I mean, why did you think that these features were important? And more often than not, people with 1 to 2 years of experience say that, that's what their manager asked them to do, right? That means you have applied some tools. Within a year or so, that tool or that particular problem statement will be outdated. So you shouldn't be outdated. Your thinking process and your approach is always constant, right? So that's why I concentrate specifically on take a problem statement. Let's say somebody solved a basic problem in regression on credit revolving score, right? Ask specifically to explain the features. Because if they didn't study the features, they didn't apply any sort of analytical thinking or basic feature engineering in there. That's a first sort of filtration criteria. And obviously when they know a little bit more about their features, then we go and ask them, did you try out a baseline regression or a GBDT? Let's say people don't want to build it and they said that by my own neural networks, yeah, I applied it. And I, for a matter of fact, still struggle in deep learning frameworks. And it's a work in progress for me as well. I can say that honestly, because they are probably 1 to 2% apart and business wouldn't care so much, right? But when we ask the candidate, explain why probably a neural network is able to leverage these features, right? And what are the loss functions which are used, and probably explain back propagation to us. These simple concepts help us understand that, the candidate understood the end-to-end learning process as well. If that is missing, then even if he comes in into the company, we throw out a new feature or a new problem statement, he's going to struggle a lot. So that's something which we want to avoid at any cost. Yeah, so these kind of basics where, you tie up the feature or the importance of it and how you apply. If a candidate clears it, we send it across to like second round and third round. And post that, we can easily train a candidate on a particular tool, but we can't train a candidate on analytical thinking.
So it seems like it's not so much about the buzzwords. It's more about thinking about problems, about understanding the tools that you're using and the concepts underlying them, and understanding the data. That's also like a big piece of what you look for. Okay, great. So there are a few questions, and maybe I'll just read out questions one by one. And then after that, if people have more questions, please feel free to post them in the chat. We will take more questions now. So one question is, please share your experience about the game theory course that you've taken. What did you learn? Why did you take this course?
Awesome. I think this is one of the primary courses I've taken when I was in doing financial engineering. I came across this course because I was going through all the Coursera courses. I don't limit myself in data engineering or machine learning engineering or deep learning frameworks, because these are all kind of domain knowledge which Jeffrey Hinton and these guys have built with their experience, with their analytical thinking. So that's just one thinking, right? In game theory, one of the things which it lets us build is strategizing, right? So that's why I picked up that course, the advanced course as well. I spent a lot of weekends in learning it, that and social network analysis and probabilistic theories, because these are the foundations across which analytical thinking and statistical inferencing are built on. Specifically, game theory didn't add any value in my day-to-day business as well, but it's just one of the perspectives I could add.
Yep, I think the lesson there probably is that, like, as you approach or as you explore different domains, especially things like game theory, not all of them may have a direct impact on your work, but they help you train your mind. They help you see problems from different perspectives, and you never know when a certain perspective might come into picture, right?
Yeah. I mean, we work on problem statements in Dream 11, which are, you know, we have tried out a hell lot of things. Okay. Like one of the problem statements, let me not get into the details, but deep learning and typical supervised machine learning fail utterly. So we have to rethink about it from scratch, from, you know, basic clustering and then applying a couple of heuristics, send it out and then explore, exploit. So we have to set up the entire process from scratch. And if we would have thought about it only from a supervised learning point of view, we couldn't have approached anywhere. And we researched about some of the fields like genetic algorithms and then dynamic time warping. These are never the techniques which somebody teaches us, but these are some of the things which we gain by understanding the problem, always keeping an open perspective.
Great. Next question, I think you've covered this briefly, but just because it's a very important question for everyone here, please share your thoughts on how to get your first data science break without work experience in data science after doing online courses or a program like this one that we are currently doing. So one is that, please share your thoughts on how to get your first break. Would you consider such candidates, or what would you look for?
If, let's say, I'm recruiting for a startup, ideally work ex wouldn't matter, because based on work ex, the pay also increases. That means the startup can't afford you. So from a startup which has limited funding but good problem statements to solve, they are definitely looking for people who are enthusiastic. If I'm hiring for that particular startup, then you know, even though you don't have a good work ex as well, your analytical thinking is one of the things which we would really look at. And if not that, and you, even if you haven't worked on any machine learning problem itself, we look at some of the other problems you have dealt with, like even like analytics work which you have done. Maybe for a fresher, it doesn't matter, because we don't really look at how much business revenue we drew in your previous company or for like another fund you have managed for the college applications of these. No, but we pose some problems which are core to regression and random forest, because these are the basics. We don't specifically ask these. If a user candidate, we pose an open question like a candidate, what are you more comfortable with? If he picks up SVM, then we keep a sheet behind it and we study it. Okay, this is something which I have bare minimum knowledge on. If the candidate also has that bare minimum knowledge, then well and good. We can prepare in our next interview down and ask him on that problem. But in order to catch your first break in machine learning without any experience, I would say be open to working on any problem I mean, 6 months or 8 months of unpaid internship doesn't matter, especially with the high rewards coming into the future. But go to the place where they have multiple challenges. Ask the team if they are taking you up for an internship, what kind of roles you have. But if you're looking for a paid work kicks and going to a company, there are a lot of companies. Like in Bangalore, it's a treasure heaven these days. I am hearing about them. So more than approaching the work with a pay in the initial part of your career, look for an exciting team who are into problem solving and especially delivering for the business, right? But if you go into a core research team who are working on, let's say, an isolated problem within fraud detection on one feature of user fingerprinting, then you are very much limited. I mean, even if at work pays you like, let's say, 100% more than any other company, you're just limiting your growth in there.
Right. And I, this is something that I often point out in one-on-ones that I have with people is, you don't be afraid to take like a small pay cut, 10%, 20% from whatever it is, because it's, think of it as the tax you pay for getting into this domain, which is by far the fastest growing and the most exciting domain. And once you get into this domain, then the opportunities multiply just like anything, because the demand is only growing. The demand, like every company is growing the amount, every company is collecting a lot of data. They don't know what to do with it. There will come a point when you will have to start using that data, otherwise your competitors will beat you. So not only that company, but every company in a certain domain will suddenly start hiring hundreds of maybe thousands of data science professionals. And at that point, obviously, because of the supply demand dynamics, the demand for you having a data science professional experience for a year, couple of years, having knowledge of machine learning is going to just skyrocket, right? So do you agree with that, Aditya, with that analysis?
Actually, one good thing you mentioned is the tax, right, analogy. I would 100% agree to it, because consider people who, many of the job requirements would ask for either master's or 5 years of work ex, right? That is the tax which they're expecting you to work in there. And consider a person who has a PhD and then research assistant experience. He then goes into a data scientist role. He has paid the tax of 5 to 8 years working under the professor. So relative to him, you are getting it easy way, right? I mean, working in a startup for 1 year on multiple problems. So yeah, I would agree on it. Like initial stages, don't worry much about the pay, just the team and the kind of exposure you get.
Right. So once you get good at these things, once you get real world experience, then your demand will automatically grow, right?
Yeah. Once you get this holistic experience and you still can't find a job, please reach out to me.
Okay. There are a couple of questions about infrastructure. Sorry to keep you longer. Can we take 10 more minutes?
Sure.
Okay. All right. So there was a couple of questions about the infrastructure. One is, how much of knowledge, how much does the knowledge of ETL and data pipelines, etc., help in a data science role? And second, okay, let me just let you answer that and then I'll ask the second one.
Okay. Two perspectives. One is how much it is important for the problem, and the other one is whether it is a viable domain to get into. First problem is it even important, machine learning engineering, right? I think it is the most important. As I said, model development is only 1 to 2% of your time you spend. And sometimes we even hardly spend about it. Ek model bana diya, and then we use the same kind of model with same hyperparameter tuning, which runs in a couple of hours, right? But the rest of the time is about designing these features and engineering them at scale is what we work on. And more often than not, your project is gonna be evolved into 10 to 15 different models which you try out. Now you need to maintain them, orchestrate them. Like, let's say from the ETL layers, mostly in a startup, there is no distinction between data engineer, DevOps, and all those. You're the only guy. You have to build everything from scratch. So think about leveraging the tools which are there. Don't write those pipelines starting from scratch, building Kafka on your own and all these. businesses these days can expend a little bit of money to have those AWS tools readily available.
Right.
Now, when these ETL tools are not present, you'll be writing those code bases and maintaining them over a period of time. And this is where I'll come to my second part. How viable is it as a business, as a career opportunity? So a machine learning engineer, based on the recent benchmarks, gets paid like 10 to 20% more than an applied scientist who has done a PhD. Okay. Because it's the demand and supply right now. Okay. Like for every applied scientist or a data scientist role, which we have, there are probably 20 to 30 people applying maybe, but for a machine learning engineer who has a similar skill set, feature engineering, modeling, statistics, decently good, there are hardly like 1%, 2% applying for like 10 roles which are available. So that's a field which is right to be coming about. And that is a bare minimum for every company which has spent 1 year in machine learning, because the tools are going to be so much that somebody needs to maintain it in an efficient fashion.
Right. So this seems like having the additional knowledge of ETL pipelines and tools is very helpful, especially if you have to do some machine learning, ML engineering work, right? Yeah. Okay. Then there is another thing about just maintaining the consistency of the learning platform. Like the you build some models and then they're in production, and then how do you sort of keep the infrastructure consistent as scale grows, as different models have to be tried? Any advice on that?
As you know, Akash, we were using Jovian before as well in terms of revision and everything. And then when the teams grew up, you know, and the kind of deliverable projects also, we had our own in-house repository system. And then not one single tool solves everything. We have one of the MLOps built in Qflow, some of them built on Dask systems, some of them in Spark systems, right? And some of them recently we have deployed on TensorFlow architectures as well the last 1 year. So people, data scientists are going to explore everything which is at their disposal. But when things grow at a huge scale, especially machine learning engineers and MLOps are like a rarity these days, the burden falls mostly on the data scientist itself to maintain. So having that perspective from our initial days itself would help you a lot, especially in a startup. And once you know how to arrange these tools, you will have to create a tech debt period every 8 months or every 1 year, so that you go reformat your code bases, spend that time, so that you build an orchestration tool, deploy most of the other services in a common platform. Because after 1 year or so, you know where the product is and where it is headed.
Right. So at that point, I'm guessing you're probably also researching the state of the art and are trying to learn, like somebody on the team will go and learn these tools and so on. Right. Great. So I guess then what you're saying is you have to keep rebuilding your ML infrastructure as the company goes, as the problem grow, as the kind of data sets, the kind of features and all change as well.
I think one of our oldest models is like 3-4 years older. It is still running, but the kind of infrastructure it is seen changed every 6 months to a year.
Okay.
Because interesting. Yeah.
Okay. I will take maybe a 2 or 3 final questions. I think we've answered all questions in the chat. So if anybody would like to unmute themselves or like just post a question in the chat, we can take a question. Okay, I don't see any questions, but yeah, if you have any questions, please post them in the chat. So maybe just to close, I would love to touch briefly on some of the recent interesting things that you've been working on. I know that you've explored deep reinforcement learning quite extensively, although I don't know if you have applied it professionally, but I know that you've been playing with that. And I know you're also looking at causal inference and causal machine learning. So can you just talk a little bit about those fields and your perspective there?
Sure. The deep reinforcement learning, right? the applications in our domain especially is personalization systems. So, and also revenue forecasting systems, which we have. And these days it's finding its way in a lot. And graph neural networks are some other things which people are maybe exploring on as well. And we have also been trying to fiddle out. But deep reinforcement learning, especially, you know, RL policies, why it is really important for us is, you know, like we can build multiple models, but these models, let's say neural networks will be able to leverage these non-linear features, apply some transformations, right? But they need a lot of domain knowledge to fine tune it. And in a startup, I would say the only constant is change. Startup will keep on changing the kind of users who will be coming in and everything. So the network which you trained a year ago is definitely outdated. So you have to forget about it. So at early on stage, if we could build a system, especially in personalization systems and also in kind of exploratory frameworks, develop a model which is intuitive, baseline, which would have contextual bandits or bandits kind of a framework wherein you direct your APIs into different models. And in here, if you want to apply any deep learning kind of a framework, well and good. But only when you have an exploration kind of a system, not just from a model, but your thinking point of view, it will be helpful. And the other one, sorry, Akash, what was the other one which you mentioned?
Causal inference and causal machine learning, yeah.
So very rarely from a startup perspective, you know, you build a model, you deploy it to prod, well and good, because that's the only model it works, it's fine, right? But 6 months down the line, you build another model and you deploy it to prod. You would definitely have to do an A-B testing in there, right? Unless and until we do that A-B testing, we would never know whether our model, which we have built for 6 months and put in our blood and sweat, works or not. So once you do that, the experiment analysis is the most important. And experiment analysis is always confounded. Like say, let me give a simple example. If let's say we want to find out the death rate of smokers versus non-smokers, you know, maybe the people who are depressed smoke more and people who are depressed might be having a higher death rate. So we have to account for other features, not just the features you have and the experiment which you conduct. And I would say within 6 months of the projects which you are working on, you will definitely come across these where you have, let's say, built a model which has the highest recall and AUC. But then comes the next revision of the model. And the business is expecting 0.5% improvement in revenue. And 0.5% is not something you can see because of the fluctuations. You have to go and do causal inferencing and statistical analysis on top of it. So that's actually a field which only Netflix, Facebook, Apple, these are the companies which are doing really heavy work in publications.
Right.
Keep an open eye.
So it's very interesting that people, that based on the model, you then, based on the correlations and the results, you go back and you look for what might be the causal features and the causal data. That's interesting. Okay. All right. One final question. I will let you go. Is how do you, is the question on everybody's mind, how do you do it all? You are leading a machine learning, you're the principal data scientist at Dream 11. You work with such large data sets and you are learning on the side. You're constantly exploring new ideas, new fields. And I know there are at least 10 other interests that you have, which we can spend a lot of time on, but definitely like things like the Iron Man. So how do you manage it all and also balance work and life and family?
I would say doing these kind of things help me put sharp in my field, because only exploring in my field, in specifically machine learning, will keep me outdated because you go down in one field that is more interesting, but at the same time, keeping some family time and doing something like Ironman training or even weightlifting, these are the kind of things which give me some perspective to think about. And machine learning projects are definitely an endurance race. Okay, from what I've learned from my experience, Kaggle competitions are short-lived, but industry problem statements are an endurance, because business is always pushing you to deliver. And you know, you are under a clock to deliver the results, and you know that hundreds of experiments you conduct only 5% deliver, right? So you are playing the long-term game. So getting that ready for that mindset is not something you can do alone by just practicing machine learning. That's other things which we need. Or there easily you might go into a depression in this field. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Any parting words, Aditya, for the budding data scientists in this gathering?
Nothing much. We can circle back to our original discussion. It might be a lot intimidating, but keep solving your problem, guys. I mean, take up any work or any problem statement and keep having this work in different domains to have multiple perspectives, as I said. And more or less than not, within 2 years, you're going to be a senior in your domain, and you're going to mentor people, learn from them. So your learning later on will come from your team and your juniors, and not just from you. So yeah, even though it is difficult, keep speaking to it.
Great. Thanks a lot, Aditya. And thank you everyone for joining. This is a great conversation. I can go on for a long time. I have so many more questions, but I'll let you go, Aditya. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks.
Bye.